share together. You will minister your word to us, Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to 1 Samuel. Go back to our text. 1 Samuel chapter 10. 1 Samuel chapter 10. I'll read verse 24 of 1 Samuel chapter 10. And Samuel said to all the people, "See ye whom the Lord has chosen, that there is none like him among all the people." And all the people shouted and said, what did they say?
God save
their king. You know, from where we've read, you see when Saul was anointed as the first king in Israel, like we told us, though it was not the perfect will of God at that time, it was a permissive will. But God still took control of the whole situation. The whole ceremony that led to the anointing of Saul being the first king in Israel. You see from where we've read in verse 24, and all the people shouted and said, "God save the king." Here you see the whole nation, the intercession, the prayers of the whole nation of Israel for Saul as their first king. The prayer that God will save the king, that is, the king will live. His reign over them will be prosperous and will be blessed. And you see this pattern of prayer whenever a king is anointed, is appointed over the nation Israel. In fact, there is a particular nation today that one of their items is titled along the lyrics, the weddings of that passage of scriptures where we've read. Whenever they have a king over them, they always say, "God save the king." If they have a queen in sovereignty, they will say, "God save the queen." If you look at 1 Kings chapter 1, you see that's the pattern of the children of Israel since the time they started having kings being ruled, being appointed over them as their ruler. In 1 Kings chapter 1, 1 Kings chapter 1, I will read from verse 39 of 1 Kings. "And Zadok the priest took an oil of oil out of the tabernacle and anointed Solomon, and they blew the trumpet, and all the people said," what did they say?
"God save
King Solomon." They prayed for him. They prayed the blessing of God, that God will save the king. His reign over them will be prosperous. His reign over them will be blessed by God. God save King Solomon. The same thing you see in 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 11. 2 Kings chapter 11, I'll read verse 12. "And he brought forth the king's sons and put the crown upon him and gave him the testimony. And they made him king and anointed him. And they clapped their hands and said, 'God save the king. God save the king.'" You see from all these references where we've read, the nature of the children of Israel, the responsibility of the nation, praying for those that God has anointed, praying for those that God has appointed over them as their king, as their rulers. And like we told those during the time of the question and answer, that whatever thing was written in the Old Testament was written for our learning, for our understanding, that we through the scriptures might have hope. That's why you see Paul the apostle, when he was writing to Timothy, he told Timothy now that this responsibility of praying, this responsibility of shouting, "God save the king," that we as a church, that believers, as Christians, we need to take it upon ourselves, because it is our responsibility. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, chapter 2 of 1 Timothy, I'll read from verse 1. Chapter 2 of 1st Epistle of Paul to Timothy, chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 1. I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. In all godliness and honesty, as Christians, it is our duty to pray and to intercede for our rulers, for our leaders, for other believers, and all men, as we are exhorted in this epistle of Paul the Apostle to Timothy. It is our responsibility. It is our duty as we go through the time of, you know, of electing new leaders, as we go through the time of this Brexit, as we go through the period, you know, of having leaders in our society. We as Christians, we should take it upon ourselves to pray for the leaders, to pray for those that the Lord has appointed over us, not only in the society, also in the church, and not only in the church, but also for the whole society, for the men around us, your neighbors, those living around you. It is your responsibility to pray for them. That's why today I'm considering the message titled, "The Believer's Responsibility of Interceding for Leaders and All Men." The believer's responsibility of interceding for leaders and all men. We need to know that this ministry of praying, of interceding, when we talk about to intercede, what does it mean? It just simply means to pray on behalf of another individual. To intercede means to pray for that brother. To intercede means to pray for that leader. That leader that God has placed over you in the society. To pray for the kings. To pray for the rulers, our political leaders. You know, as we go through this period of Brexit, to pray for them. Our spiritual leader, our Father in the Lord, our regional overseer, and all the other leaders, the pastors in the local churches, your own pastor, your own local church, we pray for our leaders. Not only that, we pray for ourselves. You look at the families in the church, we pray for each other. You make it your duty as you have your personal devotion, as you have your family devotion, that you teach your children, you teach your family to pray for a family in the church. You know, not everybody needs to come to you and say, "This is the challenges I'm going through." You may not know their challenges, but you pray for them. You look at our students, you see that they are having a period of examination. You pray, make it a point of prayer in your devotion, your own personal life. That is what the Lord is calling us to today. And also in our society, you pray for the sinners around us, our neighbors, you pray for them. Look at those who are having challenges. Look at your neighbor. You know that your neighbor has been bedridden. He has been in the hospital, in and out of the hospital. You have to pray for her. You have to pray for him. That is our responsibility. That is the duty the Lord has given to us. As the children of Israel cried and shouted, "God save the king." So the Lord is calling us today that it is our responsibility to pray for one another. To pray for our leaders, leaders in the society, leaders in the church, our friends, our family members, other members, members of the same church with us. Those who have one challenges or the other, we take it upon ourselves to pray for them. And as we pray, the Lord will answer our prayers. I say the Lord will answer our prayers. You know, the devil will always do whatever he can do to stop a church from praying. I'm telling you, brethren, the devil will not be bothered. You continue your preaching, he's okay with your preaching. You continue your evangelism, he's okay with your evangelism. But as long as you still continue in your prayers, the devil will do whatever to stop a church, an individual from praying. I'm telling you. Because he knows that prayer is the secret weapon of a Christian. That's why you find it out. It's easy to read the Bible. It's easy to come to church. It's easy to go to an evangel to go evangelism, but the moment you want to go on your knees and say you want to pray, I'm telling you, at that moment, the battle line has been drawn with the devil. And he will do whatever he can do to stop you from praying, but the devil will not stop you. Amen. Tell yourself, the devil will not stop me. I will pray. Because prayer is our weapon, brethren. It is the Christian, like we sang to, it is the Christian bread. As we breathe in oxygen, think of a Christian that is not praying. He's a dead Christian. He's a dead Christian. If you've lost the altar of prayer, you've lost the ministry of intercession. You see people today, they struggle for position in the church. But when you call people, let's come for prayer, you find it difficult to get people to pray with you. But you say, oh, my brother, when you preach today, you will always get them to preach. You always get them to do evangelism. You always get them to teach the Bible. When you say, my brother, can we pray together? Can we spend time? My sister, can we spend time together to pray? I'm telling you, that is a difficult thing to get in the church. But this church will not come to that level. Amen. We are going to pray. And as we pray, the Lord will answer our prayers. And the kingdoms of Satan will be shaken. I said the kingdoms of Satan will be shaking. Amen. This power of prayer, the devil will not take it away from us in Jesus' name. Amen. It is our duty. It is our responsibility to pray. And we are going to pray. Pray for the church. Pray for the society. Pray for our leaders. Pray for ourselves. Pray for each other. And as we pray, the Lord will answer our prayers. Amen. I say, as we pray, the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. For better understanding, quickly, I consider this message under three subheadings. In point one, we want to look at the biblical record, the records of scriptural intercessors. Are there intercessors in the Bible? Are there people that have taken it upon themselves to pray for others? Do we have examples at all in the Bible? This we see in point one, the records. Then we see the requisite, the requirement for sincere intercessors. If we must pray, there are some requirements. If we must come to this ministry, this responsibility, it's not everybody that can pray. Prayer is not for every dictionary. It's not for every stranger. There are some requirements, some requisites that the Lord demands if our prayers will be answered by him. And then point three, we look at the relationship among saintly intercessors. The relationship, like you see in the case of the children of Israel, you see the way they were all united. There was harmony among them. Not that somebody is saying, one is saying God save the king, the other one is saying God punish the king. No, they all shouted with one voice. They all cried with one voice. There was a relationship, and they prayed together. I'm telling you, we are going to pray together. And the Lord is going to answer our prayers in Jesus' name. Records of scriptural intercessors. You go back to our text where we've read in 1 Samuel. You see there the example of the children of Israel praying for Saul that was anointed, the first king in Israel. I've shown you in 1 Kings chapter 1 verse 29, the example of Solomon too, when he was appointed as king. The nation prayed and said, God save King Solomon. And then you see the example of Abraham in Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18. You know, Abraham at this time was praying for Lot. He did not consider what Lot has done against him. He did not consider Lot, you know, his nephew that he has chosen, and then went against him, and you know, took a choice portion and say, well, even though you are my uncle, you know, since you've given me the opportunity to choose, I will go for this fat one. But when Lot went into problem, Abraham took it upon himself to pray for Lot. And not only for Lot only, but also for Sodom and Gomorrah. That's the example before us. And you see the example of Moses in Exodus. Exodus chapter 32. Before chapter 32, you see Moses praying even for Pharaoh as a king in Israel. Remember, Pharaoh was the one holding the people in captivity. Pharaoh was a wicked king. But yet, Moses never confronted Pharaoh physically. He prayed for Pharaoh. Even though the plagues came upon Pharaoh, one by one till he got to the tenth one, Moses, we always go before Pharaoh and pray for him. Even though Pharaoh was of a hardened heart, Moses still also prayed for Pharaoh. What are we learning from there? No matter how difficult that leader may be in the nation, no matter how people may think that leader, and so this one is wicked, this one is doing that, he's a dictator, he doesn't listen. We as Christians, we don't join in all those political debates. We rather take it upon ourselves and pray for our leaders. And the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. And then when God promised Moses, I said, Moses, look, this nation Israel, let me just destroy them. In Exodus chapter 32, Moses was not selfish. Moses did not say, oh God, yeah, if that is what you want to promise me. So the Abrahamic covenant will now come to me. You know, that Abraham covenant will be destroyed. How we now have the covenant? Moses did not say that. He didn't do that. He was not envious of the everlasting covenant that God had with Abraham. Even though God made him the promise and said, Moses, leave these people. Let me destroy them. I'm going to raise up a nation through you. Moses was not selfish. Moses was not looking for position. Moses was not looking for get another nation out of the nation Israel. But he took it upon himself and he interceded and he prayed for the people. You know, look at Moses. Even though the people, you know, some of them grumbled against him, some of them murmured against him, some of them, they even came to the extent that they wanted to stone Moses. They took up stone to stone him. Yet, Moses prayed for the people. And he went to the extent and said, God, if you don't answer my prayer, take my name away from the book which you have written. That's the criticality of the intercessor that Moses was. What are we learning from there, brethren? We need to pray. Pray for one another. Pray for our leader. Pray for our family members. Pray for one another in the church. No matter what that sister has done against you, no matter what that brother has done against you, it is your duty as a Christian. If you say you're a child of God, even though God has given you the promise and said, well, I'm going to destroy that brother and then I'm going to raise you up above him, you'll be like Moses and say, God, and that's not what I'm looking for. I'm just looking only for your glory, that your glory will be perfected in the life of that brother, that your glory will be perfected in the life of that sister. And when you are unselfish like that, when you are selfless like that, when you are Christ-like like that, in your prayer, the Lord will answer your prayer in Jesus' name. You see the example of Daniel praying for the children of Israel when they were in captivity in Daniel chapter 9. He prayed for them. He sought the face of the Lord for them. He put himself in that same captivity. He said, oh God, he was not confessing the sin of them. He said, oh God, the people have sinned. God forgive. He said, no, God, he put himself and said, God, we have sinned. We all have sinned. That's the intercessor, the scriptural intercessor. When you are praying for that family, put yourself in their shoes. When you are praying for that sister going through affliction, put yourself in her shoes. When you are praying for that brother, put yourself in his shoes. Pray with that passion. Pray with that compassion. Pray as if you are the one experiencing that challenge that individual is going through. And the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. You see the example of the early church in Acts chapter 4, when there was a challenge against the church. They were not scattered. They were not going all about murmuring. They were not going all about scattering one another. No, they came together and prayed. That's what we are learning today. When the church is going through stormy time, through trying time, brethren, that is the time to come together as a church and pray. I say that is the time to come together as a church and pray. And the Lord will answer our prayers. I say the Lord will answer our prayers. You know, that's why we told us at the beginning of this month that all throughout this month we want to pray. And we are praying already in our revival services. We are seeking the face of the Lord. And the Lord will answer us. And the Lord will answer us. This church will not die. I said, this church will not die. This church will fly despite the storms of the devil against his church in Jesus' name. Point two, the requisite for sincere intercessors. There are some requirements. There are some conditions. If our prayers must be answered by God, you see in that same 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 10 verse 24. 1 Samuel chapter 10 verse 24. You see the Bible says that all the people of the children of Israel, no strangers among them, no visitors among them, no dissenters among them. They were all united. They were all members of the commonwealth of Israel. If God must answer our prayers, you must be a member of the commonwealth of Israel. If your prayer must be answered by God, you must be a member in the kingdom of God. If you're a stranger, the Lord will not answer your prayers. Because the Bible says in Psalm 66, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not do what? The Lord will not hear me. If you're an hypocrite, the Lord will not hear your prayers. If you are the one, you say, well, we are praying together, and at the back, you're also destroying the church, the Lord will not answer your prayers. The Lord will not hear your prayers. If you say, I belong to deeper life, one leg in deeper life and one leg somewhere there, the Lord will not hear your prayers. We must be members of the same commonwealth of Israel. You must be born again, born into the kingdom. Because sin, in Isaiah chapter 59, the Bible tells us that your iniquity, as it is faced from you, that it will not hear you. When there is sin in your life, sin will hinder your prayers from being answered by God. That's why we must be a member of the commonwealth of Israel. That's the requirement the Lord demands from us. Not only that, the Lord also demands righteousness, holiness, humility of heart. You see the example of our Lord Jesus Christ as an intercessor. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 7, look at his example. And that's the light the Lord is calling us to. Hebrews chapter 7. I'll read verse 25 of Hebrews chapter 7. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeking he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such an high priest became us, who is holy. You see the requirement there. There must be holiness of heart, holiness of life, of life, righteousness. If our prayers must be answered as sincere intercessors, who is harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. The Lord demands righteousness. The Lord demands holiness if our prayers must be answered by him. You see, in the life of Christ, he was humble, he was righteous, he was harmless. He was a lion, but a lamb. Christ, a lion, but a lamb. A lion of the tribe of Israel, but he was the lamb of God. You see, Christ there, he was humble, separate from sinners, undefiled, spotless, without blame in his life. The same thing the Lord is calling us if our prayers must be answered by God. We must have righteousness and holiness. Not only that, there is the requirement of faith. In Matthew chapter 21, we are told there the requirement of faith is not only to pray. We must have faith in God, have faith in his promises, have faith in his word, and the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 21, Jesus answered and said unto them, verily I say unto you, if ye have faith and doubt not, you cannot be praying and be doubting. It does not work that way. You cannot be praying for the church for revival and you're also doubting, will this church be revived? It doesn't work that way. You must have faith in your prayer. You must believe God that as you pray, as you seek the Lord is going to answer our prayers in Jesus' name. Can I hear louder? Amen. Not only that, we pray in accordance to the will of God. You pray in accordance to the will of God. Don't pray for your own selfish desire. Don't pray for your own selfish will. We are praying for the church of God. We are praying for the growth of the church. That's the desire of God. We are praying that the church will be revived. That's the desire of God. We are praying that God will add more people into the church. That's the desire of God. We pray for that in accordance to the will of God. You don't say, well, God, you know, this church where you are praying for revival, but God, you must do my own first. No, it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that you put the things of God above your own personal desires. You know, we always say this thing, when you take care of the things of God, God will take care of your own thing. Can I hear a louder amen to that?
Amen.
The Lord will take care of your own needs in Jesus' name. But then after all this thing, point three, before we pray, the relationship among saintly intercessors. There must be a relationship as we come together as a church to pray. Look at the whole nation Israel. They were all united. They all shouted. No dissenting voice among them. No dissenting voice. When they say God save the king, nobody was saying God punish the king. Nobody was saying the king must die. Nobody was saying, oh God, you know, this king, Saul, make him a wicked king. No, they all shouted with one voice, God save the king. That's the relationship. When we come together to pray, we must pray in an harmony of heart. There must not be division among us. Like we told us on Friday at the revival service, we pray in agreement, in one agreement, in unity, with a united heart. We seek the face of the Lord. We are told of the early church in Acts chapter 1, verse 14. Let's look at it together. Acts chapter 1, the relationship among saintly intercessors. What should be our relationship? It should be a relationship of love, of unity, of one purpose, of the same mind. In Acts chapter 1, verse 14, this all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. They all continue. Harmony, that's a relationship of love, united heart, operating together. No disunity among them. No division among them. No carnality among them. We are all in one accord, praying unto God as we come together to pray. There must be harmony. There must be unity. There must be love. Jesus said, this new commandment I've given unto you in John chapter 13, that ye love one another as I have loved you. The Christ-like love. It is love that will make you to pray for your brother. It is the Christ-like love that will make you to pray for your sister. It is the Christ-like love that will make you to pray for the church of God. It is the Christ-like love that will make you to pray for our leaders in the society. As we go through this period of Brexit, we want to take it upon ourselves as Christians. You know, we are coming to a critical period now. We want to pray that God will guide our leaders, that they will not make mistakes. We want to pray that God will save our queen, that God will save our nation, that God, you know, in some countries now in Africa, they are going through the period of election, and whatever country you came for, you want to take it upon yourself and pray. As you are praying for the leaders here, you're also praying for your own Jerusalem, the leaders in your own Jerusalem, remembering them in prayer, and the Lord will answer our prayer. As we pray with compassion, we pray with love, we pray with kindness, we pray with a sincere heart. You are not doing it for showmanship. You are not doing it because I want people to know that I'm praying. In your own secret there, you are praying. If we come together as a church, we are praying. And the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. When we pray, there should be no division among us. There should be no debate among us. There should be no discord among us. When we come together as church, saintly intercessors to pray. We pray with one mind. We pray with one purpose. And the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. Today the Lord is calling us to this duty of praying, interceding for our leaders, for our nation, for our members, for a brother, for that sister sitting near you, You take it upon you. Look at the church. People you don't see in the church today, you go back home. You pray for them. You call upon the Lord. Some of them have challenges. Some of them have needs. Remember their needs. Take it to the Lord in prayers. And as we pray, the Lord is going to answer our prayers. I said the Lord is going to answer our prayers. Remember, when we pray, there should be no division. There should be no discord. There should be no debate. There should be no jealousy. There should be no envy. There should be no bitterness. We pray in the passion, with love, with forgiveness. We pray with one heart. And as we pray, the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. It is our duty. The Lord is calling us as your nation at the time of the anointing of Saul cried, God save the king. So the Lord is calling us that we should pray for our leaders, for our pastors, for our national leaders, for our civil leaders, and for the leaders the Lord has placed over us, and for one another in the church, and for all men, sinners out there, in your neighborhood, remember them in prayers. And as we pray, the Lord will answer our prayers in Jesus' name. Let's rise up now and go to the Lord in prayers. We want to commit ourselves to the hands of the Lord. That the Lord will help you, my brother. That the Lord will help you, my sister. You are going to pray. You will pray. You will remember that brother. You will remember that sister in prayers. We will remember one another in prayer. As a church, we are going to pray. We are going to pray for the church of God. That no matter the fire, no matter the fire this church is going through, the enemy will not prevail against his church. That this church of God will go through this fire. And the fire will not consume his church. That this church of Jesus will stand. We pray for one another. We pray for our leaders. Let's remember our Father and the Lord in prayers. Let's remember our regional overseer in prayer and all the other leaders in the church. Pray for them. Our pastors, your local pastor, yeah, pray for him. Let's remember their families in prayer. They need your prayers. They all cry, God save the king. Let's pray that God will save our leaders. God will grant them prosperity, breakthroughs in their ministry. Let's talk to the Lord in prayer. And the Lord will hear our prayers.